been a discussion. I'll call this meeting to order. There's been a discussion about the agenda, given that it's now 10 o'clock, and we normally try to finish our meetings by now. We will skip over 2.4, sports group signage. None of the rezonings on tonight's agenda were of an urgent nature. Obviously, the urgent nature is the items started at item 10 and go through. I'd like to include 14 since the consultant's in the room, as well as 15 and 16 and 17. And the two liquor licenses could be skipped over, as well as any of the items on the public hearing, particularly the two controversial ones, if council so wished. But that doesn't save us any time at all, really. Okay. We're going to skip over 2.4, but apart from that, we're just going to go straight. Madam Clerk.
Item 1 are minutes of the regular council meeting held Monday, December 3rd. The recommendation is that the minutes be approved.
Councillor Asmundson, Councillor Reamer, all in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Item 2 are minutes of the sports council meeting held Wednesday, November 14th. The recommendation is that the minutes be received.
Councillor Robinson, Councillor Nicholson, all in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Moving over to 4. Item 3 are minutes of the Multiculturalism Advisory Committee meeting held Wednesday, November 21st. Recommendation is that those minutes be received.
Councillor Reamer and Councillor Nicholson, all in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Item 4 are minutes of the Maillardville Commercial and Cultural Revitalization Advisory Committee meeting held Thursday, November 22nd. The recommendation is that those minutes be received.
Councillor Reamer, Councillor Robinson, all in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Moving to item 10, fourth and final reading of City of Coquitlam 2013 five-year financial plan and capital program bylaws. The staff recommendation is that council give fourth and final readings to City of Coquitlam 2013 five-year financial plan bylaw number 4367, fourth and final reading to City of Coquitlam transportation development cost charge reserve fund expenditure bylaw number 4356, fourth and final reading to City of Coquitlam parkland acquisition development cost charge reserve fund expenditure bylaw number 4357, City of Coquitlam parkland improvement development cost charge reserve fund expenditure bylaw number 4358, fourth and final reading to development cost charge reserve fund expenditure bylaw 4359, fourth and final reading to sewer development cost charge reserve fund expenditure bylaw number 4360, and fourth and final reading to water development cost charge reserve fund expenditure bylaw number 4361, 2012.
Second.
Moved by Councillor Reamer, second by Councillor Nicholson. All in favor, all opposed? Carried. Councillor Nick, Councillor Sikora.
Go ahead if you wish.
Councillor Sikora, I think you've got some comments.
Thank you very much. I'd like to ask the Treasurer a couple of questions. Number one, how many positions were not filled in the city during the last year? We used to get a report every 3 months of how many vacancies there was in the city. But I noticed that that's been kind of eliminated, or we haven't been getting it. How many positions was there at the end of the year, or right now, that's not being filled?
Thank you, through the chair. We do provide that information with the trimester report, so we do provide that 3 times a year. I don't have those numbers with me tonight, but I'm estimating about 50 vacancies, of which about 30 of those are backfilled. So there's probably only 20 that aren't backfilled, and that can be, you know, they can be vacant for a week or a month or 3 months. So it varies depending on the position.
So if there was 20, and let's take at $60,000 a year, that'd be well in excess of $1 million in surplus on that alone.
It wouldn't all be surplus, because we do an allowance for vacancies in our budget. We did $750,000 vacancy allowance in this year's budget. So basically the vacancy savings are taken up by that.
Vacancies, as far as I'm concerned. You can mince it the way you want, but it's that, okay?
But we've already deducted it from the budget.
The one thing that, I noticed that, you know, Port Moody was 6.65% their budget. You know, and I know a lot of people say, gee, look at Port Moody, we're way lower than Port Moody. So, you know, but the casino money, okay, we get about $8 to $10 million a year. Am I correct? Maybe 12?
Actually, we get $7.2 million a year.
Same answer you gave last time.
A year?
Pardon me? $7.2 million.
Okay, $7.2 million. So that's 7%.
Approximately, yes.
Okay, so 7% and 3.34%, that's over 10% budget. That's what it would be if we didn't have the casino money.
Well,
like Port Moody doesn't have a casino money. Port Coquitlam doesn't have casino money. Can you imagine our city, if you took the casino money away, what our budget would be? And we're talking about restraint and hard decisions, tough decisions, and everything else.
But you know that the casino money isn't used for operating. It's only used for capital.
I know, but you know what? It is. If we didn't have the casino money, we'd have to come up with that 8 point some odd million or 7.2 million or $8 million out of some other money.
Well, assuming we spent it.
Some other money would have to come in.
No, we wouldn't be building.
We wouldn't.
You can shake your head, Councilor Robinson, as much as you want. You know, don't go shaking your head because it might fall off, you know, if you shake it good enough. Because, you know, number one, $7.2 million, if you didn't have that $7.2 million to do roads and many other things, you'd have to come out of it from somewhere else. You'd have to tax the people for it.
Or we'd not spend it on the capital items we spend it on, because it's dedicated to particular capital items.
It's, you know, I mean, you know, here we are arguing, you know what? I've been at it for 40 years, and I know budgets. And I know how to do budgets. So, you know, you can't tell me that somehow the casino money doesn't count in our whole operation. So why are we getting it? Maybe we should give it back to the casino.
Well, Councilor Secor, we don't use it for operating, but it does count in operating because we build facilities with it and we have to pay to operate those. So it actually costs us extra operating costs to have the casino revenue because we spend it on operating
saying.
Capital items that have operating costs tied to capital.
Mayor Stewart, you know, I was born at night, but not last night. You know, the fact is that, you know, I know budgets, and that you're correct. The fact is, if you didn't spend, you spend it on building infrastructure. We used to do it before without the casino money. You know, and how did we manage it then? But now, you know, we're making all these tough decisions, and everything else is very tough that we're making these great big decisions and everything else, and very tight on a budget and everything else. But yet we're way higher than Port Moody if you took the $8 million into consideration. We'd be way higher. We'd be about 11, 12% in our budget. And that continues on a yearly basis. So, you know, I'm not going to dwell much longer because it's now 10:15. But, you know, I remember when there was recessions, we had a manager manage two departments. In other words, the planning, the engineering manager would be probably manager of engineering and planning, or the planning would be a manager planning. You know, that is cutting to the bone. That is cutting to a bone. We now haven't cut anything, and I'll tell you what, the recession is coming. There's no question about it. And we'll feel the pinch. And nothing will happen. We'll say, well, we went through hard times, but we're living on a casino money that brings us about 8 to 10% a year. And those are the things 4%. That, you know what, you can't forget about that at all. It's part of our budget that is in our budget. And if we didn't have that money, one council member said this afternoon, well, we have the money, so we spent it. We financially very well off. So we spent it. What happened if there wasn't that? Think about it. What would happen? This council couldn't live with that budget. The council members would thought that $8 million couldn't live with it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it would just reduce our capital budget. But anyway, that's Councilor O'Neill.
Yes, thank you. After we gave initial consideration of this budget, I took great pains to talked to the people of Coquitlam about it. I put it on my Facebook page, I blogged about it, and everywhere I went, I told people what the budget was. And I have not received a single word of complaint about it. Rather, the opposite. People are very happy that for the fourth year in a row, the rate of the increase has decreased. And of the many things that I talked about a year and a bit ago on the campaign trail, that was one of the prime ones, that I would work to decrease the rate of growth. And we are doing that. I didn't do it by myself, but we've all done that. And I think that's a really good direction. If some councillors don't like that direction, I don't know exactly what would make them happy. Councillor Secor and I did talk about this a bit before the meeting, and I did respond to him that if we didn't have the money, we wouldn't spend it. As simple as that. You know, we have this money, and we are therefore able to give spending it on capital projects the people of Coquitlam sort of services that our annual poll tells us that they want and would like to have. And we're in a very lucky position, and I think each one of us around the table realizes that we are in a very fortunate position that we're able to respond to some of these requests from the community. Poirier Sports and Recreation Center, building new fire hall. If we didn't have that money, we would have to make some hard decisions, absolutely. But Councillor Secor is raising a sort of a hypothetical straw man here, of the sort that really doesn't deserve much more consideration, because it's a hypothetical straw man. It doesn't exist. It's not a situation. And you know what? Mum always said, my late mother always said, we'll cross that bridge when we come to it. We've got no bridge to cross right now. If indeed something like this happens where we lose our casino money, let's cross that bridge when we come to it. Let's not put up some sort of hypothetical problem right now when no problem exists. That money is coming in, and if it doesn't come in, we adjust. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you. Well, Councillor Secor may have done many budgets, and I have a lot of respect for that. But I certainly get frustrated when we try to mislead the public on how we use casino funds, because I think it's important that everyone has clear understanding that the budget that we passed is not about and is not dependent on casino funds. That casino funds, because they're not predicted every year, we're dedicated as a council to make sure that it only goes to capital projects. So we're not dependent on that funds. And I think our neighbors are challenged with their budgets for other reasons that has nothing to do with the casino. So I'm pretty frustrated that the public gets misled down that garden path, and I would ask Councillor Secor that he not continue to do that. And keeping changing the numbers, last week suggested that $12 million was what came in from the casino. We were told and reminded by staff that it was $7.2 million, but that keeps getting forgotten. So I think it's really important that we remember it's $7.2 million that we get from the casino now. And that could change next year, the year after. That could be more, it could be less, and I think as a council we do a pretty good job to make sure that we don't become dependent on that. Thank you.
Thank you. I was going to make that point. The casino fund actually does cost us operating. We don't benefit in the operating side of our budget, but instead we're building a swimming pool, so our operating cost goes up. We're building a new ice rink, so our operating cost gets added to, because we have those new facilities. Our citizens benefit from them, but there's an operating cost attached to it, and our operating budget therefore must go up in order to accommodate that. These are good things. These are benefits to our community for the next generations, but they do have a cost attached to them. So it's important to remember that the casino doesn't supply operating funds. It supplies capital dollars. Councillor Reid.
Thank you. When we started getting casino funds, we made the decision what we were going to use them for. And I just want to give Sheena McLeod a lot of credit here. people hear us say, as Councillor Robinson, Councillor O'Neill, and the mayor just said, you know, we use them for capital projects. Yes, we do, but that doesn't mean that if, gee, we want a new pool, well, we just go out and buy it. We can use those, and Sheena is masterful at doing this, so please know, residents, that you've got someone who is masterful at doing this. But taking the casino funds and use them to leverage, use them to build up our reserves, use them to put us in a place where when we need to borrow, we can borrow at the lowest possible rate. Some of the rates we've been able to borrow at this year, it's a crime not to borrow and be putting your own money out because you're actually doing better that way. So we get casino funds, granted, but I don't think I could ever see anyone else that hasn't used them in this way. I think you do a masterful job, Sheena. Thank you.
The question is fourth and final reading on, I'm not going to read them again, a whole bunch of bylaws related to our budget. All in favor? Opposed? Councillor Sikora remains opposed. That motion carries almost unanimously. And I do want to add, at the conclusion of our budget, there's two more budget-related items, but this is our budget passed. Council's consideration and thanks to all of the folks in the Finance Department for, again, an incredible job well done, and all the folks in all the departments for making sure that we're as fiscally tight as we can be so that we can weather the challenging times that so many communities are having so much trouble with, that we're doing pretty well. And it's largely because we can take our hat off now to staff for the work that they've done. Madam Clerk.
Item 11 is fourth and final reading of 2013 Water, Sewerage, Drainage, and Solid Waste Rate Amendments. The staff recommendation is that Council give fourth and final reading to 2013 Water Distribution Amending Bylaw Number 4373-2012. Give fourth and final reading to Sewerage and Drainage System Amending Bylaw Number 4374-2012. And give fourth and final reading to Solid Waste Management Amending Bylaw Number 4375-2012.
On our utilities. Moved by Councillor Asmundson, second by Councillor Nicholson. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 12 is fourth and final reading of City of Coquitlam Fees and Charges Bylaw Number 4338-2012. Staff recommendation is that Council give fourth and final reading to Coquitlam Fees and Charges Bylaw Number 4338-2012.
Moved by Councillor Robinson, second by Councillor Nicholson. I'd like to suggest we go through these one at a time. Okay. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 13 is fourth and final reading of City of Coquitlam Intermunicipal Business License Bylaw Number 4355-2012. Staff recommendation is that Council give fourth and final reading to Intermunicipal Business License Bylaw Number 4355-2012.
Moved by Councillor Hodge, second by Councillor Reamer. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously. 14. Okay.
Sorry. Item 14, Development Site Management Review. We have introductory comments from our city manager and a presentation by Joseph Diosege of City Works Consulting Corporation and Rob Wilson from RK Innovations, Inc.
Your Worship, in October of this year, we had a significant rainfall after a prolonged dry period, and that resulted in a number of the sites up on Burke Mountain not performing as well as what we had hoped for and what we had come to expect would happen. And as a result of that, we did commission an independent review about how Coquitlam was dealing with development and runoff and rainfall type issues, and we commissioned Mr. Diosege and Mr. Wilson to do that review. Both of them have extensive experience in both development and runoff issues, and we've had some significant discussions on this. And just to simplify and to summarize it, both Joseph and Rob have four or five slides just to give a very quick 3 or 4 minute overview of the issue. And there will be a series of reports back through 2013 on this issue, but this commences a number of actions that we are recommending. So I would ask Joseph and Rob to come to the mic at this point to just give a few overview comments in that regard.
Thank you, Your Worship, and members of Council. We have carried out the subject review in 3 weeks' time, which was obviously very, very short. The findings of the review is broad, and we found that over the last couple of years, the city of Coquitlam made a number of very significant improvements in their processes. A few to mention: strengthen the bylaws, particularly the bylaw enforcement notice bylaw. The city provided more enforcement of the bylaws, including the signage bylaw, stream and drainage system protection bylaw, and so on. The city also established an environmental and worksite bylaw officer position, and the second one is in the works in the 2013 budget. Also, significant progress has been made on signage and show home issues. However, there is still a number of things what could be and perhaps should be improved. The report's recommendations are many, in fact over 20. These are sorted in short and medium term recommendations. And just to highlight a couple of them, I'd like to mention the City Cares program as a potential initiative to strengthen the public image of the city. That program, once developed, could be a multifaceted program, including a signage campaign. We believe that if signage at construction sites will include more information, the public, stakeholders, contractors, and developers will pay more attention to environmental issues, and overall it's going to be for the benefit of the city. We believe also that various key stakeholders would be interested in participating and assisting the city in this program, such as the steam keepers. Also, we would recommend more staff presence at construction site and more visibility of that staff so that orderly construction activities would be achieved and more respect could be paid to the environment and to public property. There's a possibility that the program, which doesn't have to be a high-cost item, could be partially funded by developments. The second and most important recommendation of the report is related to the ESC bylaw, and I hand it over to Mr. Wilson.
Your Worship, the single biggest issue, as Joseph identified coming out of the review, was the need for improving the overall erosion and sediment control in the city. And the reason for that becomes evident when you compare the city's erosion and sediment control risks and regulations. A quick comparison to other regions or cities in Metro Vancouver. The city of Coquitlam, particularly your northeast sector area, actually has the highest cumulative erosion and sediment control risks of anywhere in Metro Vancouver. And that's due to the fact that you have a lot of tree clearing and land development associated with your developments in the northeast sector. And that's combined with, and it's being done in an area where there's topography and steep terrain and the potential for high rainfall. But on the other hand, the city's ESC regulations are now over a decade old. The technology has advanced a lot in the last decade, and a lot of other cities have done a lot, and the industry has improved as a whole with regard to erosion and sediment control. So the solution for the city is to adopt an enhanced and ESC management strategy that consists of three components. First and foremost, as mentioned, an ESC bylaw will be developed through consultation with your industry and your customers and staff, and it'll be brought back to Council in 2013. And along with that, there'll be an implementation plan that deals with enhanced city staffing and training. And lastly, there'll be new and improved customer service and resources for your customers. So those things collectively, as part of a strategy, will enable the city to really raise the bar and ensure that your erosion and sediment control management is in keeping with the risks that are posed in your northeast sector and your city as a whole.
Thank you, Your Worship.
Thank you. Councillor Asmus.
Well, Thank you for your report. So I find it's a very good, all-encompassing report. And I've been dealing with this issue living on Burke Mountain, as Councillor Hodge has. I've been pushing for changes, and there's been changes, as you noted in the report, and improvements over the last 3 years in our standards. But we still have a ways to go. And what you're dealing with here is the environment, the runoff, the siltation issues, but also the social impacts of construction. So I'm very pleased to see those two aspects of it. We put in an environmental work site bylaw officer. The budget is approving another position moving to deal with better on-site constructions. And I like your immediate actions over the next, I won't go over the next, the 10 items in there, but it does give us a good guideline moving forward, and especially, as you noted, upping up our bylaw from this 2001 standards to today's standards. So I'm very, very pleased to see this here, and I'm very pleased for Mr. Steblin and Mr. Suzak for getting this done in a short period of time and bringing it before council, and I thank you for that.
Thank you. Councillor Secor.
Yeah, thank you very much. A great report, and that has to be done. There's no question about it. I'm just wondering, can the staff, as we have now, manage this in-house, or you'd have to hire extra staff, or what do you do, set up another?
We are intending to manage this in-house. The report does refer to additional oversight necessary but that will be reported back as part of the detailed bylaw. At this point, it is envisioned that there probably will need to be an additional city staff person to do the work associated with that new bylaw, but we believe it'll be self-funded, and it'll be a very small amount per home, and it should be funded by development because that is what is necessitating the need for that staff.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Councillor O'Neill.
Yes, thank you. Page 3 talks about the development implementation of a city cares program. And coming from a communication background, I really want when the city implements, if the city does implement something like that, that I want it to be a little more specific than that. City cares is very open. The city cares about the environment, a little less open, a little more specific. But what about the environment? Well, specifically, we care about the siltation that's getting into the system. And why do we care about that? Because it gets into a river. Why do we care about that? Because it impacts the fish. And that's where everybody from the grade 4 student to the retired person working along the stream and cleanup or something like that, that's where they really care about the healthier rivers and the fish. And I think that's near unanimous when you talk to people around Coquitlam, is that they want healthy rivers for the fish in there, and that's, they feel very good about that. So I think that if this is what they want, this is, and we're going to be giving it to them, we should be very specific about exactly why we're doing this. It's not a general caring; it's a very specific thing, I think. And I think this is what this is really all about. We should let people know this is in response to. Not the corporation of the city of Coquitlam caring as much about as the people of Coquitlam really care about the health of the rivers, and we're implementing something to respond to those cares. Thanks.
Thank you. No other questions?
Thank you.
Motion's moved.
We're good?
We're good. Okay. The motions are before us. All in favor?
It has not been moved. And
Councillor Rasmussen told me it had been moved, but now he's moving it. Councillor moved by. Yes, exactly. Moved by Councillor Rasmussen, second by Councillor Reamer. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 15 is final reading to zoning bylaw text amendments for parking requirements related to transit-oriented development strategy, bylaw number 4352-2012. We do have introductory comments from our General Manager of Engineering and Public Works.
Thanks, Your Worship. I'll be very brief. This report presents clarification sought by Council regarding transportation demand management measures and the principles that will govern on-street parking management strategies. There's also a grammar corrected clarified version of the actual bylaw. And that grammar-corrected version contains no material change and other than the grammatical clarifications. Finally, this has been and probably will continue to be a difficult issue. When this issue was last considered, it was said that there was some fear and angst in the community about parking and the future of parking management. So with this information, we hope that these clarifications provide some comfort and confidence in moving forward. Thank you.
Moved by Councillor Nicholson, seconded by Councillor Robinson. Councillor Reid.
Thank you. I won't make this more than a one-minute statement. Going through this, I can agree with everything except the 1.35 reduction when it comes to two or more units. I think we're preempting ourselves. I think it should stay at 1.5, and then they can take the extra measures over and above that. I do not believe that 1.35 is the right number, nor do I believe it will be for a long time with the transportation system that we have here. And I just don't think our buses are ever going to come for about 10 years or so. So unfortunately, I will be voting against this, even though there's only the one item in it that I don't agree with, which is the reduction from 1.5 to 1.35. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Nicholson.
Thank you, Your Worship. My position is unchanged from the last time we talked about this. I still believe that 1.35 is an appropriate starting point. In the new world of people who are smarter than me about knowing whether or not they want an automobile, and the direction that we're headed in, particularly by the time some of these projects get out of the ground, the questions that I asked at our last meeting about parking management and about the relative values accorded to the transport parking demand strategies, I think are well answered in the report. The part of the report that deals with parking management is entirely principles-based, but I believe that the principle, and there's a commitment there to apply those principles as we move forward into developing parking strategies for the challenged areas, the core and shoulder areas. I look forward to seeing that work come forward, and I expect to have good, solid measures in place before the trains start to run and the people start looking for places to park. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Hodge.
Well, I spoke at great length when this came to a second and third reading, and you know, and I still believe that that we have to look to the future and look into a crystal ball and try to determine if we're going to get it right, because it's very difficult to go back and fix something. We just have to look at places in the Lower Mainland where they haven't got it right. And to me, when I drive through a neighborhood and I see residents-only parking signs all over the street, on the side of the street, that tells me that they didn't get it right, because I believe that a resident should be parking within the unit complexes and not on the street. I do appreciate that with transit coming, that there probably will be a lowering of the demand for parking, but it's a guess. We don't know. But for me, having a contingency fund put aside gives us an insurance policy that if we get it wrong, we at least have some money to go back and try to fix it. When I look at the TDM, though, and we've been given some more information here, or additional some clarification here on what the TDM measures would be, and I noticed that reading through it, it seems to be based on a $15,000 per stall. That seems to be sort of the, if you will, the currency value that's been placed here on these measures, that it's a $15,000 parking stall, and that's sort of what the credit is. And yet, in the cash in lieu, we charge $20,000. So I would hope that moving forward that we could look at the TDM portion and put a greater value on those stalls so that we do get more, because the one thing that we are trying to do when we reduce our parking is to create alternatives. I mean, this is about making good use of our land, whether it's four stories underground. I think we want to try and hit the parking right. I don't want to see a full floor of empty parking on the fourth floor underneath a parkade. So I think we want to try to hit it right, but one of the ways we're going to hit that right is to encourage people to use public transit and to use these TDM measures. And I think that in order to succeed, we have to give more measures. If it's bus passes, there has to be more. If it's parking for carpools, or if it's incorporating shared cars, I think it needs to be greater. And I think one of the ways we can make it greater is to put a greater value. So, you know, the developers are sort of getting a buy down on the first 1.5 to 1.35, and I think that's a realignment. That's coming into today's reality, and we're hoping we're right. But if we're not right, that's where the measures further down kick in. If we go too far, we at least have the ability to provide some parking through a structure or other measures. So to me, that's the insurance policy. So there's three parts to this. I think there's a realigning of where we really are today. The second part is the encouraging people to use transit, and I think we need to make that encouragement greater. And the third part is the insurance policy, that if we've gone too far with our parking reductions, that we have a fund there that we can go in and try and fix it. So I would really urge staff to look at this in-between measure now that we've sort of seen how that could be applied. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you. Well, I'm going to support this, because I think, just like Councillor Nicholson and Councillor Hodge had said, you know, we need to look forward and we need to try to get this right. What really struck me was, actually Friday night I was doing Operation Red Nose, and at 2:30, quarter to 3 in the morning, we're dropping off a lovely drunk young woman. She's just a little drunk. But she called Operation Red Nose, and she lives in one of the apartments here on Glen. And I'd never been in the underground, and so here we are, quarter to 3 in the morning. And we keep going down another level, and down another level, and down another level, and down another level. I couldn't believe it. The number of empty parking stalls was alarming. I'm thinking, are all these people out partying? Not likely. Are the suites empty, or do we have an overabundance of parking? Because I really, it wasn't like there were just a couple of empty stalls. It was like a third empty. And I think maybe council ought to have a tour at 3 in the morning of some of these underground parking stalls here. Because, so for me, it just sort of solidified that we don't need 1.5, that 1.35 should be sufficient. Because empty parking stalls are just a burden, and
we can recess the meeting at 3 and we'll go on a tour.
At this point, we could just go. So I feel very, very comfortable with 1.35. That for me just sealed the deal. So I'll be supporting it. Thank you,
Councillor Asmundson.
Thank you. And you know, I've had some issues with this and this reduction, but I've done what. Councillor Robinson's talked about. Friends bars live in some of the high rise around here, and there is an excess. Even if you take into some of the offshore owners or empty units, there is some excess in there. Within the core and this area, I can see dropping it down and it not being a problem. In the core areas, the stations, you're going to have great transit. You're going to have the SkyTrain. You're going to have buses feeding in and out of there on a regular basis. So in those areas of the city, there is going to be good transit in this area, which will be a great benefit to the people living in those areas. What I'd like to look at, and within, I think Councillor Robinson talked about, is some of these buildings have quite an excess of unused capacity. I'm looking at maybe in the future design of parking lots to have like a two-step, like a gate for the residents and maybe a front party gate that isn't used, that they could lease out or rent out and go into a strata fund. And I think that would be something, because I know it's done in different parts of the world, and it would create an issue, because we have two types of parking we talk about here. We have the residents parking that are living in there and looking at that reduction, what we're talking about. Is it specific to the town center? We're talking about destination parking. Councillor Hodge and I have talked a lot about that, and needing and where our funds can go to build destination parking, specifically, you know, for Coquitlam or the town center. But this is another way without to help up that supply in there. And I think it's something through the planning department staff that we can look at and work with, that we can create a win. We can create some excess parking, because if the 1.35 that they go down to is still too much and we still have a lot of excess, it creates a way to open up some of these parking spaces. We get the destination, the units get that, or they can have them sold off as parking stalls for people who maybe want to take transit on a regular basis, on a monthly basis. So this comes in some shared parking ideas and some other issues on this idea. I agree with Councillor Hodge about that first drop, the 15,000. I'm not going to stop this now, but I do think we have to go back and look at that 15,000 and make it 20,000. I've looked at some of the issues with here, and we talk about a transit pass, and that's a great idea, but how long is that for? Do the people get it for 1 year, 2 years? How does that translate out? The car share, the Strata has a car share given to them. They have to take over ownership in the future on that one. How does that work out? I think when they're doing that next drop after the 3.5, that 5%, I think, as we said, I think a $20,000 one-time fee for that drop would be fair on those other measures about transit passes and other things to make it work better. Because we're looking at below when we ask to drop the next level per stall. We're just saying in this one here, that 5%, just one $20,000 will help make that all work. And I think we'll get a better value for our residents and entice them into transit more often. So that's an area where Councillor Hodge and I agree that I think we need to raise the value of that part of it moving forward. And I'd like the staff to take a look at that, maybe come back with an amendment in the future. And I'd also like us to monitor, just not the shoulder areas, but I think what Councillor Robinson issued is, how can we properly monitor with the buildings and the stratas what type of excess parking there's on a year-and-a-half basis when we come back and we're talking about these things to give comfort to council and other councillors that have concerns. What is the uptake of parking within these high-rises? I think that'd be vital information for council to know over the long term. So I think I'm willing to pass this, move this forward, and continue with this direction and just monitor it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councillor Sikora.
Thank you very much. You know, I've got a whole bunch of mixed feelings with us building a reserve fund for parking. Once the parking is gone, it's gone. You know, we're going to somehow sell parking. In other words, what happens, a developer comes along, I want to build one or two stalls last while you give us $30,000. We'll give you a break. You don't have to put in two or three extra or the stalls that are required. You'll be building the last stalls. And then the roof caves in, and we're going to be putting taxpayers' land and building parking lots. That's what's going to happen. Or have street parking for residents only, and then you need to have a whole bunch of enforcement officers enforcing it. You know, and there's many places where there's all kinds of parking. Why? There's offshore buyers. That's where you see all kinds of street parking and all kinds of other parking in different places, offshore buyers. Where I live, it's 1.75 per unit. And there's parking for everybody. I think we have maybe two stalls that are not being used. That's about all. You know, and you go by my place on Pipeline Road off Guilford and towards Boza developing, every parking spot is taken on a street bumper to bumper on both sides of the street. And I bet you if you drive there right now, you wouldn't be able to get a parking spot. So, you know, those things do happen. And, you know, for us to somehow, you know, and do you think for 1 minute that developers are gonna give somebody a break because they're having the 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 10 last parking spaces? Not a chance in the world. They'll just pocket the money, you know that. I mean, why would they give anybody a break for what? We'd be selling it for $500 or $600 a square foot, and that's the way it's going to be. Just like we had a developer come at us, all of a sudden, after buying the land 80-odd acres for $25 million, they want an extra 1,000 units on their land. What do you think what that is? Greed. That's all. Nothing more, nothing less, just greed. So nothing is going to happen, you know. But for us to somehow say, give us $15,000 or $20,000, we'll give you a break on parking, I think it's about the worst thing I've ever heard. Because what happens if it doesn't work? It's too late. We've sold ourselves out. And that's exactly what's going to happen. So we'll not be supporting this. Not for 1 minute. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Sikora. Councillor O'Neill.
Yeah, the profit motive is kind of behind our economic system, I guess, and I can't blame our developers in the community for wanting to sell the right product to the right group at the right time, and so this is a response to Councillor Sikora's suggestion that when a developer comes to us and wants to change something to get more, that it's purely motivated by greed. If people aren't buying a certain product, I think any person who's in the position of selling that product has to respond by changing the product or offering a different product for sale. That's just common sense to me, and I don't think that's greed. I'm in business, used to be a freelance writer. If people weren't buying the sort of articles that I was offering to them, and if I decided to write different things and offer them different articles, that wasn't about greed. That was about wanting to sell my product. And that's the same with every industry, I think. So I wanted to get that off. But on the subject of responding to markets, and, you know, it's my instinct on this is one of a bit of laissez-faire, and you go right back to my one of my first positions that I took that kind of raised some eyebrows around here. It was about compelling any new development to have bike racks, and I had the position there that if the people wanted bike racks, the developers would respond and build the bike racks. If the people didn't want the bike racks, well, fine. Don't force the developers to put them in. And I know that raised a lot of hackles. But I still have a hard time imagining, with regards to parking, that our city will develop into some sort of a parking chaos hell because developers will turn a blind eye to a higher parking demand that this bylaw doesn't foresee. I think the market is nimble enough to change, and that if the buyers are going nuts because they're not getting enough parking, we will hear it. The developers will hear it. And it'll get sorted out. It won't be clean, and all the little rough edges won't be sanded down all in advance. But, you know, that's the way the life works. It's not always neat and easy, and we don't have every situation figured out in advance. I think the more we try to figure out every little nuance of everything, the more we dig ourselves into a deep hole sometimes. So here I'm quite happy to let this proceed. It may well be that we've set the bar too high. You know, based on what we heard a little while ago about those, it was, I think, 60 or 80 housing units that were near rapid transit that we saw, I think it was, we were told, 1.24 parking stall demand for a two-bedroom unit, that we're pretty close to that. And, you know, so if we're in the business of trying to make good predictions, I think this is a pretty good prediction, and I'm definitely ready to support it. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Reamer.
Thank you. I, too, am going to support this. Our city's being transformed,
And I think that this is a really great middle-of-the-road recommendation that staff has brought to us. I think we're not going to be fully certain for many years as to exactly how this is all going to show out. But I think that it's a well-reasoned, middle-of-the-road approach to dealing with parking. And for that reason, I am going to support it. I, too, was initially concerned with a payment in lieu. However, I have been convinced that that will work, assuming our other numbers are correct, and I do believe that they are. And so I will fully support this. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor O'Neill mentioned laissez-faire. I'm not laissez-faire, but I'm really reluctant to intervene where you don't need to, or to dictate where you don't need to. And I think that, imagine if we went to the market and said, you need three bedrooms. I mean, why are you guys building only one-bedroom units? You need to build three-bedroom units. What if you need two more bedrooms later on? The market would laugh at us, and they would buy somewhere else. And we would be justifiably criticized. I don't know, of course, parking spaces are different. And parking spaces create a lot of passion among people. But they have every bit as much cost associated with it. They're incredibly expensive. And if we get it wrong, if in fact two-thirds of the parking spaces in a building are empty, and we know buildings downtown Vancouver where they were built. These are, in one case, a co-op that was built that has almost all of its parking was empty because the people that bought into the co-op couldn't afford a car or chose not to have a car, and therefore they ended up converting the underground parking into a commercial opportunity for the co-op to make money, and they actually now sell the parking spaces to the public. That's not likely to be an option for some of our buildings, but I also don't want to err. I don't want to err on either side. I don't want to make the mistake of having too much parking, but I, of course, don't want to make the mistake of having too little. And so what we've done here is we've said we're going to let the market somewhat dictate, but we're also going to say that we're going to develop a fund that allows us to correct the mistakes that might happen. I don't know that they will. I prefer, in fact, and I've said it before, that we should be leaning toward parking maximums instead of parking minimums. We should be trying to get people out of their cars. We should particularly be doing that around transit stations. Now, if 1.3, let's take 1.3, if 1.3 is the right amount of parking for a building somewhere, and we put that building instead, we put it right next to a SkyTrain station, is 1.3 the right number anymore? Well, of course not. We got to account for something, and yet there seems to be this perpetual reluctance of us to allow some variance on the parking, even though those parking spaces are $45,000 each, and therefore the market, the buyer, has to fund those parking spaces that they don't need. We ought to be able to be as flexible as that. We also ought to be able to develop a mechanism, and I think this answers part of that. I'm not sure it's the right dollar value, but I think it's the right strategy. It's a strategy that allows us to forgive those parking requirements near transit, and to have a policy that forgives a mistake. If it turns out we were wrong in one corner, we've got a fund that allows that. At the same time, we've got to count on the fact that the same people that criticized the internet and thought it was a fad are sometimes today criticizing the idea that people can do without a car. And there are lots of families in my kids' generation, there are lots of kids that are growing up with the idea that they never want to have a car. That's $10,000 a year in costs, or $6,000 a year in costs that they don't need to incur, because they're going to use public transit, they're going to live on public transit, and they're going to get around using the most sustainable form of transportation, either their bike or their feet, or public transit. And I want us to build a downtown that supports those folks and their aspirations for a better world. I was about to end a sentence with "for a better world." Sorry. It wasn't me. No further comments.
It's fourth and final. All in favor? All opposed? Councillors Reed and Sikora are opposed. The motion carries.
I just wanted to note for the viewing audience that it was fourth and final as amended to reflect the wording, slight wording changes as well.
Point well taken. Does anyone need a second, another vote? Nope. We're good. Thank you.
Item 16, development permit authorization for a 43-story mixed-use development at 1188 Pine Tree Way. We do have introductory comments from our General Manager of Planning and Development.
Your Worship, very brief. This was a development permit with a embedded variance for some setbacks and parking. It was before council last week. At that time, council had some questions for us, which we've got some information in hand. There wasn't simply time enough to format that in another report. So this is just the report that came forward last week, but we have some material that perhaps Raul can put up and explain to you around the parking variances over time with the site. The other thing too is it's interesting because now we've got a development permit that would be subject to review under the just recently updated zoning bylaw parking regulations. So we've also got some information looking at the proposal from that late as well. So we can provide that information to you.
And, Your Worship, I'll just briefly cover the variances on the historical project. And you can see on the screen now, we've had the developer just update the total variance package over the essentially the life of the project. You can see on the top screen, M1, M2, the office building, which is currently as yet unbuilt, but it's expected to have to meet its parking requirements. And M3 is the final line on the top table. As you can see on the far right-hand side, the historical variances here, there were 21% variance granted on the phase one, 9% on phase two, and the expected variance would be 12% on phase three. When you calculate parking for all the phases, it comes in at 13%. This is essentially the calculation that staff went through with the developer based on historical approaches to variances in the city center. Just draw your attention then to the final table on the bottom. So as per the amended regulations now, once adopted, council has just adopted those, starting on the left-hand side, we've got four commercial stalls required, four are provided, so there's no variances there. There are 64 visitor stalls required, and there's 56 provided, and that's obviously a shortage of eight stalls, 12% variance. On the residential required residential stalls, there's 384 required, 362 provided. That's a variance of 22 stalls, and that gives you the 6%. Overall, that results in a 30 stall shortage. So that's not noted fully, but there's 30 stalls short on that phase. Now, just to take council through that, with a 5% reduction permitted under the parking requirements, that would reduce the required number of stalls from what's being provided to eight. Those eight stalls would then have to either be found in the current development plan as part of the building permit, or there would have to be some adjustments made in terms of the reduced floor area. Or alternatively, the developer could also take advantage of the cash in lieu option to make up those eight stalls.
Okay. Councillor Sikora.
Thank you very much. You mentioned 364 parking spaces. I thought the report said 322 parking spaces for residential. Am I correct?
Yes. Let me just. There's a variety of numbers here related to the project as presented to council last week. So there's 422 stalls provided in total. Okay, and that's absolute total stalls on the property is 422 stalls. That includes four commercial, 56 visitor, and 362 residential. So in total, the project has 422 stalls. The bylaw, as amended now, just amended by council, would require a total of 452 stalls. That leaves them with a 30-stall shortage. When you reduce the 5%, which is 22 stalls, through TDM, that leaves 8 stalls. And those are the ones that actually have to be provided for, either through a reduced floor area, additional parking being found through adjustments in the parking plan, or through the application of the cash and loot component.
Yep.
Well, I don't know. I read in here in a report there was 322. I think last week's report showed 322 for residential, and now you show 362. How did that come about? About 40 stalls that showed up that wasn't there to begin with. If you look at last week's report.
If I could, Your Worship, there's a table on page 4 in last week's report at the bottom, and it breaks it out there as Rawls walked through. That, you know, there's the commercial, there's a visitor, there's a residential component. There was a 362 proposed at that time. I guess what, in going to the new parking regulations, what there is proposed to be provided between commercial at 4, visitor at 56, and residential at 362, so there may be confusion around 362. That total is 422. So that's the number that's 8 stalls short of what the 430 that would be required under the current parking regulations. And so it's those 8 short stalls that would be either achieved through finding efficiencies in the parking layouts, like i.e. getting some more parking stalls and getting the detailed building permit design. The developer may choose to cut back on some of the floor area, or they may wish to take advantage of the cash and lieu contribution to the city to go into the parking reserve fund if they want to go that avenue. So that is those options open to the developer at that time. But we would make sure that the parking required was provided.
Well, I could have sworn that I read in last week's report 322 instead of 360-odd.
Mr. Holloway.
Yes, Your Worship. And just, I believe what's been circulated to Council is the a couple of pages from the development permit, and that does reflect what we're mentioning at this moment. On the heels of Council having adopted the amendments to the parking requirements in the zoning bylaw, these two sheets become essentially the replacement pages for the development permit that's included in your Council package. These replacement sheets now reflect the fact that that what was previously a parking variance, which is prior to the zoning amendments, is now nested and codified in the zoning bylaw. Therefore, we've pulled those sections out, and we've noted how the existing plans would have to be adjusted to accommodate parking as per the new parking requirements.
Okay. Also, you got 4 stalls for business for 2,100 square feet, and I know that, you know, I think it was the mayor that mentioned that there'll be other stalls that are available throughout the development. Okay, in residential, I'm sure it'll be gated, unless you have a certain button that you press, you can't get in. Okay, then it'll mean that it'll be using the visitors' parking space, which is 12.5% short as it is. Am I correct?
And they're not dedicated spaces, commercial.
Four spaces for commercial only.
We have 4 for commercial, which actually does meet the required.
How can a business exist with? See, I'm a businessman. You know, there's no way that I would rent any, lease any building that's got 4 stalls for businesses or survive in there. Even if I was a notary public, or if I was a, not even a dentist, not even a veterinarian, not many, many other people couldn't possibly survive with 4 parking spaces. So, of course, they're going to use visitors' parking spaces. That's the only one they're going to be available for them, and you're already short of visitors' parking spaces.
Your Worship, if I could. No, that's very true. And in fact, a developer would often have a very difficult time leasing commercial space unless there is sufficient parking for that tenant. I guess the thing to note, and this came up last week, was just the fairly modest amount of commercial that's going into this phase. Into the M3 is not very much commercial square footage. I think it's in the order of
units.
Two units. And so the bulk of the commercial in this, the M project, would be around the corner where there was more commercial and visitor parking. So,
2,100 square feet is a pretty good chunk of a commercial in a building if you've got only four parking spaces.
For 2,100 square feet, Your Worship, it works out to four stalls.
And pardon my expression, I don't know, what kind of business would you perceive going there with four parking spaces only? Can you tell me what kind of business is going to be? A barber shop? What is it, for 2,000 square feet?
Your Worship, the combined commercial on this project is substantial. There's going to be a significant office component. There's a variety of office and commercial spaces. This particular phase along Pine Tree does have a couple of units fronting Pine Tree to activate the street, so there's going to be, it'd be up to the developer, obviously, to market that space, but it is going to be well-positioned to provide active retail frontage, this is just one small component of the significant amount of commercial employment space in this project. So, but we are providing for a mixed, both commercial and residential visitor use of parking on that level.
Sounds good, looks good. But it's impractical, as far as I'm concerned. There's no business will survive with 2,000 square feet, with 2,000 square feet with four parking spaces. I'm sorry. Thank you very much.
Councillor Nicholson.
Two questions, or one question for staff and one comment, I guess. The table that you've given us, showing the historic variances, those variances are based on the standards in effect at the time that the variance was created, not on the current?
That is correct, yes.
That was my assumption. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Oh, Councillor Reid is at it. Go ahead.
So let's talk about the four commercial spaces. Councillor Sikora feels that whoever rents the 2,100 square feet is going to have exclusive use of the four commercial spaces, but that's not true, correct?
That is correct. There's a shared space in that parkade level where there's both shared commercial and visitor space.
So you've got 2,100 square feet, and you can park now and then, but it's not a dedicated spot. So this gets so complicated. So this particular one, because we've got three or four sites all combined in a metropolitan family, shall I say, and because they were all done under different rules and regulations, I guess has a different view. I find myself now in the position where I still firmly believe that 1.5 is the number, and I can believe that till heck freezes over, which I probably will. I know there's developers out there that when they decide to put a high rise in, they won't even go in the ground until they know there's 20 or 30 or 40 or more percent sold offshore overseas, which no one will ever even move into. They'll just sit there. So to be driving around in a new area right now and finding a floor or so vacant is not a surprise. Whether we have the right number or not, and that is true, Councillor Robinson, and I'm hoping that my added was that I'm hoping we're going to be talking about this at our retreat in January, and I'm hoping I can get some numbers for you. It's quite fascinating when you start looking at what really happens out there. And I guess we all only learn on parking from what we've done, as we talked about earlier about the Northeast. And I look to downtown Vancouver and I look to the Joyce Street station, and I look to those places that it's just been a disaster around Commercial Drive and places like that, and they have the best transit, better, far better than we'll ever get. So my problem is this. Now that council has voted that this new law is the law, if I want to deal personally with any of these new developments, and I happen to love this new development, I like everything about it, so I want to be able to vote for it. But I will say out loud, with every development that comes forward, I do not believe in the parking. I think it's wrong. So I've said it. Until it can be proved to me otherwise, that's what I'll have to do. I will vote for the building because I happen to think it is fabulous. It's a fabulous building. Where I'm sad about this is we've talked about flex parking for months now, and we've had some developers and that tell us how well flex parking can work, and that's where Councillor Asmussen was talking about. And after the last meeting or so, I was sort of hoping that we could use the main floor, the ground level, as a flex parking space. It's another way that stratas can get money, and it's another way that we can get a lot of parking, which the money doesn't come to us, but it certainly goes to the strata. But it also provides parking spots that are close to all these little commercial ventures. And I guess that didn't go forward, so what the heck. But I think we've got to be a little pushy on this. And on this particular building, it's been going on too long now, and there's too many buildings and too many sites all combined, and densities and that combined. So I really don't feel I have a choice. But I do think that we're really making a mess of this parking. Thank you.
Move recommendation.
Second.
Thank you. Any further discussion? The development permit is on the table. All in favor? Opposed? Councillor Secor is opposed. Carries almost unanimously. That's 11:15. Okay. Citizen appointments. Moved by Councillor Reamer, seconded by Councillor Robinson. Discussion. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously. I want to thank those citizens who put their names forward and who have waited patiently all night until 11:15 to find out whether they got appointed. Well, you got appointed. Thank you very much. May your meetings go shorter than ours.
Item 18 is an application for a structural change and permanent change to a liquor license for Mickey's Public House located at 170 Golden Drive.
I suggest we set aside both of the liquor license applications for another day.
And there's a notice of motion. In 30 seconds.
These won't take long.
Move a
second. And did you finish reading?
There were two options before council, either a public consultation or opt out of commenting.
Moved by Councillor Nicholson, A, seconded by Councillor Asmussen.
I have a quick question.
Councillor Reed.
Thank you. Just quickly through to staff, in both of these applications, it said somewhere too that the reason they're doing it is because we seem to have a standard that's set across the city. Is that correct? I don't remember doing that.
There's no standard hours. There, Liquor Primary can request hours till 4 a.m., but there's varying hours depending on.
Well, they're all going till 2 a.m., and they're saying that to meet up with their competition, but I didn't think that we had a standard.
Well, rate. Their competition is the one that goes till 2 a.m., I think.
Well, that's why I'm asking, because I didn't realize.
There's no standard.
There was a standard. Thank you.
Mr. Dumont, you have a... No, nothing. Okay. I believe there is one that goes... My understanding is that there's another one that goes till 2 a.m., and that now has become the standard in the city.
Exactly.
And my own hesitation to going with option A is because we're going to own all of this public consultation if we do this. My own preference would be option B and let the province deal with it and resolve this thing, because ultimately the standard in Coquitlam isn't 2 a.m. The neighborhood pub that you and I go to, or that you go to and I go to, closes at 1. And from there, some of the staff head down to the Boone County because it has one that goes till 2. Councillor Nicholson.
Thank you, Your Worship. I think that option in any of these, the right thing for us to do is send it to public consultation here in the city. That's a cheaper process for the applicant than going with what the liquor board requires, and it gives us the opportunity when it comes back, as we did with one a little while ago, to say, okay, we've heard from the neighbors, the application is for these hours, but we think these hours would be reasonable, and we can send that word on to the liquor board, and we've responded to the needs of our people. I would further ask that not tonight, but one day soon, we consider whether we can find a process by which staff automatically goes to A, because I can't imagine one of these coming to us where I would not prefer to have the process done by us, handled by us, and cheaper for the applicant, and retains our ability to give input to the liquor board. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Reamer.
Thank you. Thank you to Councillor Nicholson. I completely agree with your comments. We always want, we know our neighbors, our neighborhoods best, and I think that is a wise thing for us to do the public consultation and then to be able to provide comment at the end of the day. I just want to mention that traditionally, since I've been on council, which has been since 2008, generally speaking, we normally go with A. There may have been one where we didn't, but generally speaking, we've always gone with A, and so I fully support going with A. I think it's the right way to go, and I'm going to recommend that for the next one that's coming along here, too. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Sikora.
Thank you, Mayor. You know, this one, this pub is long way away from any residential. It's all business. So I don't think there'll be any opposition. But however, I think what we need to do is have a policy in these council chambers that every pub can adhere to this kind of regulation, these kind of hours. Otherwise, you know what's going to happen? This one is here today. Next week, there'll be somebody else. A week after, there'll be somebody else. A week after, there'll be somebody else. So let's put a standard to where they all have the same hours. Extended hours, I see nothing wrong with that. If somebody's working midnight shift, gets off at midnight, wants to have a beer before they go to bed, it's fine, you know, rather than staying at home and drinking alone. That's the worst thing you can do, is force somebody to go home, pour himself a drink, and be a lone drinker at home. It really is, you know. People go to a pub, they'll have a beer, and they'll be able to talk to somebody and relax and a few other things. I think it's a great idea, but, you know, I think we should put a standard in as soon as possible. And I'm just commenting to the city manager, see how maybe we can get some kind of bylaw going as far as a standard is concerned for all pubs. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm loath to do something because we always do it that way. But anyway. The motion is A. All in favor of A. All opposed? I'm opposed, and A it is.
Item 19 is an application for a permanent change to a liquor license for a liquor primary establishment for the French Quarter Pub at 925 Burnett Avenue. The staff recommendation is A, that council approve one of the following options: A, direct that a public consultation process be initiated, or B, opt out of commenting on the application.
Second. Moved by Councillor Robinson, second by Councillor Nicholson. All in favor, opposed, carried.
Item 20 is the Metro Vancouver Board in brief. The recommendation is that council receive the brief for information.
Second.
And I have a notice of motion.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried. Now, I want to go back to the zoning. Go to item 5. Madam Clerk.
All right. Moving back to item 5. These are the public hearing items from this evening. Item 5 is City of Coquitlam Citywide Official Community Plan Amendment Bylaw Number 4365 and Zoning Amendment Bylaw Number 4366 for 352 Marmont Street. The recommendation is that Council give second and third readings to Citywide Official Community Plan Amendment Bylaw Number 4365-2012.
Second. Moved by Councillor O'Neill, second by Councillor Nicholson. All in favor? Opposed?
Opposed.
Councillor Reid is opposed. The motion carries.
The second recommendation is that Council give second and third readings to Zoning Amendment Bylaw Number 4366-2012.
This is the zoning. Moved by Councillor Reamer, seconded by Councillor Robinson. All in favor? Opposed?
Opposed.
Councillor Reid is opposed. The motion carries.
Item 6, City of Coquitlam Zoning Amendment Bylaw Number 4364-2012, 1408 Austin Avenue. Staff recommendations that Council give second and third readings to Zoning Amendment Bylaw Number 4364.
Moved by Councillor O'Neill.
Second.
Second by Councillor, the two Irish keep doing this. Second by Councillor Nicholson. Councillor Nicholson.
Thank you. It's been so long since the public hearing. Can I ask staff to refresh my memory as to what we're waiting for to go to fourth reading? They can't remember either, Your Worship.
Oh, my apologies. I thought we were on. My apologies. Just checking the item we were on. Yes, this the
we're
Austin
not on
project.
Housing agreement. No,
the Austin project. It does have. This one has a development variance permit. It doesn't have a development permit because that is typically delegated to staff. But it does have a development variance permit for lot width, and that does have to come
which
back.
We'll see at
which
the same
you will
time
see, and
meeting.
You will see the design of the new design of the site, and you can see there's additional parking on that, which we will try to obtain.
Thank you, Your Worship. Sorry to do they things.
No, I have the same. I need another parking space. So. Councillor Asmussen.
I won't be supporting this. When I look at this as a housing choice, it's on a street of Austin that won't have any parking on the street. It's a mid-block piece of land. It is a laneway. The laneway has issues with it. If it was fronting a local street with a laneway with street parking on the front, I could then support this application. But the way it is with the parking the lane, I can't support this application. Thank you.
Councillor Reid.
The only way I'm going to support it is because you can come up with two or three more parking spots and do some tandem. And with that, I can support it. Because we're going to have developments come in all along that block, and it's steep as heck at the front. So all we've got is the lane, and we need to be taking a look, see a lot of stuff we're doing. Anyhow, I will be supporting it because of the extra parking spaces.
Councillor Hodge.
You know, this one I'm really struggling with because. You know, it works to achieve what we're trying to do. And when I look at the development, it looks like a great development. It reminds me of what we saw when we toured North Vancouver. And, you know, I like the courtyard, and I like the design of the houses. And I like the fact that, you know, that maybe they can squeak a couple of parking spots in there. But it's Austin Avenue. And there isn't the parking on the street for visitors or people that are stopping or people that are coming in for a visit, and the lane in the back someday, it's going to be a wider paved lane, but it's not today. And so I'm really torn between the long term vision, but that residents in this neighborhood are going to have to put up with 8 cars coming and going from that gravel lane and construction, and it's going to get chewed up. And I just, you know, if even if this were an existing paved lane, but we're really facing a sort of a chicken and egg thing here, is that, you know, I want to see that development start, but I know that if we put this development in today, there's going to be problems in this neighborhood. Although the long-term vision, I think, is right, but where do you jump in and start? It's too bad it's in the middle of the block and not at the end of the lane. I'm really struggling with this one because I so want to see developments like this in Coquitlam, but I don't know that this one is going to work in the neighborhood just because we know how bad, you know, Austin Avenue is, and we see this gravel lane at the back, and we know that every car coming and going from these houses is going to go in and out that little gravel lane, although it'll be wide where this house is. You know, it's too bad that four residents hadn't got together and all brought a development to at the same time, and then we could have done a stretch of the lane, and maybe there's others that are coming in 6 months or a year from now, what we don't know. But this one could be done in isolation, and that's going to create havoc for the residents on Charlin. So I really want to support it. I appreciate the extra parking spot, and I like the look of the development. It's everything we want, but I don't know that this neighborhood can take it. So I'll listen. I'd like to hear what some of the other councillors say.
Thank you. Councillor Reamer.
Thank you. I'm not going to support this. There's very poor access only through the back way there, not through the front way. There's going to be parking problems for the neighborhood, I think, in this particular instance. You can't park on Austin. If there was a street right in front of it, I might consider it. Or if there was another access in as well, I might support it. You know, looking at the development, I was kind of wondering to myself, you know, whether or not there could be, you know, a driveway through the project somehow. And I didn't see that. I have seen that on some of our other applications. And so I just... I can't see this one working for the neighbors, even though, as Councillor Hodge mentions, this is where we want to go in Coquitlam. But in this particular instance, I just I don't think it's going to work, so I'm not going to support it. Thank you.
I have the same issues that other council members have. I support the zoning. I'm left, though, with one or two parking spaces not insufficient. And from my perspective, and I look at the cross section, which is attachment 6, and I'm wondering whether it's possible to put a parking stall inside the back houses in the basement, one in each, and common driveway down the middle or something that provides another indoor parking space or two, and get rid of one of the garages. Some solution that allows that we have the capacity in tandem for visitors, because that's where my visitors park. They park behind me, and if I ever have to leave, then people juggle their cars around. But right now, I'm left with the visitors parking is the 7-Eleven or the church across the street on a very busy street, and I don't want either one of those being used as a church as the visitors parking for one of these buildings, because the next one doesn't have anything then. So I'm going to support it, but I recognize that staff have suggested that there may be we may have to go back to the property owner. I'd even be willing to look at a roof deck, the deck of the main floor of the back house being the roof of the garage, for a single car garage, one on each side, and have an expanded deck that allows some backyard space that, granted, is a deck space. We're going to end up with more pavement, but ultimately I don't know that there's another solution here, because we've only got enough width for 7 parking spaces, not 8, not 9. So by allowing, say, the outside parking space to become a deck as it approaches the building, and allow a tandem solution there. Other than that, I'm struggling with this one, so I'm going to support the zoning, and I'm looking for a solution out of the designer / staff. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you. I'm in the same place as you are. Mr. Mayor, as well as Councillor Hodge, because I love these kinds of designs where we're taking these properties and we're densifying. But the ones that we saw when we went on our tour, they weren't on this major arterial, and that's what what I struggle with, is that there is no frontage, and any access is very limited access. What also caught my attention is the letter of support for 1420 and 1416 Austin, who I think is ready to do the same thing, that he's here to support this one, and if this he goes, then he's going to go with his two properties. So we can anticipate some uptake on this, should this be supported, which would hopefully sooner than later upgrade that lane because it needs to be done. But I also am anxious about the parking because the truth is it's that neighborhood is going to get inundated, potentially inundated. And I would like to believe, I'll support it sort of tentatively because I'd also like to see a bit more creative design around getting more parking out of this site, because I think that that's going to make or break these going forward. And if we don't get these done right, it's going to be really hard. So if we can't get it right, I'd rather refuse this one and wait till the right ones come along.
Your Worship, just a commentary. So before council right now is the bylaw to zone the property to a zoning which would RT3, which would accommodate. In fact, under this zoning amendment that you see before us, the only thing that could be accommodated on the site is a triplex. Okay, it's the variance that comes forward later is what would allow the consideration of a variance to relax the frontage requirement for a quadruplex. So, and I'm just trying to put something out for council. A number of council members are expressing concerns around the amount of units on the site and the impact it has on the parking. One of the solutions or one of the answers to this would be to, through direction, that the site could be a three-unit project. If a variance were not to come forward, the applicant under this zoning amendment would be able to do three units. He'd have to come back with an amendment, with a plan through staff that accommodates three units. Now, typically that would not come back to council. It would look very much like it does today, but just imagine one of those units not provided and parking being provided in that, sure, on that location. So that is one possible solution that council. The benefit of that is that it also provides the message on other lots on Austin that, you know, that while housing choices can be accommodated, we are not prepared to relax property sizes in such tight circumstances where, what otherwise might be the case.
Right. That's one possible solution. That's very, very useful information because that's what I'm worried about. As a one-off, that might be, well, maybe, but there's going to be a whole bunch of folks who are going to want to do that, and I don't know that this neighborhood can handle it. So if we pass this, all we're doing is we're saying you can build three. I feel much more comfortable with that. Thank you.
Yeah. Councillor Nicholson, how are you doing?
Thank you. That was very helpful, and all I'll do at that point is express my support for second and third reading. Look forward to fourth.
Motion is second and third reading. All in favor? All opposed? Councillor Hodge is opposed. Councillor Asmussen is opposed. Motion carries.
Item 7, Zoning Amendment Bylaw Number 4354, is a text amendment to permit accessory amusement arcades within the CS1 service commercial zone. The recommendation is that Council give second, third, fourth, and final readings to Zoning Amendment Bylaw Number 4354, 2012.
Moved by Councillor Zecora, seconded by Councillor Reamer. My own perspective is this is a big mistake. Councillor Nicholson.
Thank you, Your Worship. I can't support this. I hope most of you found the message from Kathleen Wallace Deering on your desk. Her language was more forthright than I was thinking of using myself. Kitty gambling machines. Let's train people so that they're ready for the casino when they're a little older. I just don't need it. I don't think it's an appropriate thing for us to allow in our community. I'd like to understand just a little better exactly what these things are. I have a horrible feeling that they already exist and that this amendment is intended to regularize a practice that's been going on. Well, I guess I'm going to ask staff that question.
Okay. Mr. Allen.
Yes, I believe there are some, although I'm not sure that there are as many as they want or they need. I have young children. I've been in these places that they're, you know, they spit out tokens and you need 800 for a lollipop or something. It's quite, I do
even
think
worse
there are
than
some.
The casino. Yeah.
So it is, we've been advised by Crash Crawlies, who actually are the sponsors of the amendment, although we basically looked at it as just loosening things up a little bit. It's still a fairly tight bylaw amendment here. They've indicated they need the allotment provided in here for their business model, and we feel that that there are already some on site. This just allows them to modify their operation to make that operation more profitable. But there are some on site already.
Well, we've all said often that the profit motive is a wonderful thing, but I don't think it speaks to every possible action to earn profit, and I don't think I can say anything better than Kathleen Wallace Deering did. I can't support this, and I won't. Thank you.
Councillor Reamer.
Thank you. Just to provide some history, because I am the one who took the telephone call from Crash Crawlies, or an email, and it asked me basically what approvals they needed for these particular games, and then after, I can't get into the rest of it because it was with legal counsel, but that's why this text amendment essentially has come forward. The fellow didn't need approval for what he was asking for, but then that made us realize that we didn't have this within our zoning amendment bylaw, and so therefore staff came forward with it. So that's kind of how it happened. It was an innocent question that was asked by the vendor to us, and then we realized that we didn't have that capability within our zoning amendment bylaw, and so this is to rectify that situation. Thank you.
Councillor Sikora.
Yeah, thank you. Would this be these amusement arcades, would they be in a separate building by themselves, special zoning, or would you be able to see them and service the gas stations and also in restaurants or that type of places? Where would you be able to see these? These would be separate kind of business area?
They're very, very specific. They have to be the bylaw amendment that was brought forward does indicate that they have to be an ancillary use to a just going back to my bylaw. So they have to be an ancillary use in conjunction with an indoor play center limited to 10% of the floor area. It must include token operated machines only, so not money, and it has to have the same access as the rest of the business, so you can't have a separate access. So we have limited very strictly these uses, so that they literally will only operate as part of a, you know, Coco's or Crash Crawlies or some other children's center, and in fact many of these don't have those kind of machines today.
Okay, thank you.
Councillor Hodge.
So just so I'm getting this, they have them now, but this is just to bring that so that they're now conforming? Is that what we're talking about? This isn't sort of an expansion of you can have four, now we're going to eight. This is your basic, can you have them at all? Is that sort of... Is this a zoning change? So presumably the zoning doesn't exist now.
I'm going to ask if we activate Councillor Reamer's microphone. She seems to have part of the answer, and we'll perhaps get to Mr. Oliva as well. Councillor Reamer.
Well, when the email and the request came in, Crash Crawleys was wanting clarification on what was required to have these type of games. The word arcade wasn't used, rather the word, and there was a word before game to describe it.
Amusement.
No, it's not amusement game. It's
open
operated. No, it's not that either. It's
addictive. Sorry.
It's a name, and actually it was referred to in that email, Councillor Nicholson, that you referred that you referred to.
Open operated.
Yeah.
Redemption.
So anyway, this Crash Crawleys thought that a license was required to get these particular games. I was under the impression that he did not yet have them, but he wanted to bring them in. That's the impression I got from my discussion with him.
We should talk and put it in there.
I don't see any need for it.
We're okay.
Mr. Alueva.
There are some.
I've remembered. Redemption games. Redemption games.
There was some question during the business licensing component of this project and what they obtained machines and with the understanding of what they were, going back to what the zoning permitted. And they, as a result of that, it made us look at our zoning to determine exactly what these were, and the understanding was that they were not permitted under that particular zoning. At that point, we had to decide whether. Do they make sense under the zoning or do they not? And we felt that, by and large, as an ancillary, and taking aside the legality of how these machines came into place, we looked at these centers, these amusement centers, what these machines are relative to the rest of the children's entertainment complex. And as an ancillary part of that, the feeling was that it was not something that was out of place, so we felt that we could support that.
But they exist in other locations within our city, in other businesses that have them. Is that because those other businesses are in a different zoning, or is that because that we've just never dealt with this before to actually formalize it?
I don't think that's a lot of
Your Worship, these machines currently they're permitted under C2 in planned shopping centers only, or under CS1 as an adjunct to a movie theater, and you'll see if you go to the to the theaters.
That's what I'm thinking of. We
yeah.
see them
so they
Silver
are permitted.
City,
they are permitted there as amusement arcades. Now, what we've created here is an ancillary amusement arcade. It's a separate use. It's an amusement arcade that's specific with specific restrictions that are supposed to be an adjunct, an ancillary use only to a children's entertainment center. So it's actually a much more limited application of this. It's not one of these amusement arcades. These are not in vogue anymore. They do exist. Obviously, they're highly been competed out because of the all of the gaming, the electronic gaming. But so this particular amendment, it does not touch the amusement arcade use. It's actually creating a sub or an ancillary arcade, amusement arcade that's specific to a children's center, and then it has substantial limitations as to how they could be how it would have to be run and operated. So in fact, its application is very, very specific, and only to support a children's game center to a very limited amount.
And I do believe they exist in other municipalities.
In conjunction.
Yeah.
You good?
Yeah, I'm. This is another one. You know, philosophically, I don't like them. I don't like them anywhere, actually, where kids use them. I think it's fine for kids to play pinball and, you know, Even the shoot 'em up games and other things, you put your quarter and you get your 2 minutes of play and that ends. I struggle with the reward part of it, that it is a form of risk reward. It's not just you put your coupon, your token in and you get the play for 2 minutes, and then when your time is up you drop another token in. It is a reward risk type thing. So philosophically I have a problem with it, but we're allowing it at other places within the city. So this is just a case of, are we going to, and to me, it's a little bit like when the lotto machines went into the bars, is that, you know, at some point you just sort of say, they're allowed here, do we allow them to the next step, and where do you go from here? So to me, it's a progression of something that's already existing. We're now just asking, are we going to allow them here as opposed to only over there? So I see where we're going with this. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm trying to understand the distinction between this and the space at the theater that I think does the same thing except for the redemption. Silver City has a electronic space.
Silver City has these machines. They're coin operated. I believe they're also redemption. There are redemption. The tickets come out, and there's some
token, and
you put in tokens, and there's redemption tickets that come out, and those are then redeemed at the counter. I believe they used to be that way. Maybe that's changed. It's been a long time since I've seen a movie.
You can go later tonight.
Yeah. Catch the Hobbit.
Anyway, is their bar closed?
Yeah, midnight showing. It is the same idea. We are very, very specific, understanding the potential social concerns of this. We're very, very specific on this particular amendment. I would just maybe summarize, yes, there are redemption uses out there. Currently, they're very limited in application. Like I said, only in shopping centers under C2 or as an adjunct to a movie theater. All this would do is add a definition in the bylaw, which would create accessory amusement arcades, and it would only be able to be accommodated as a specifically to support a children's center. So as noted in the amendment, would be permitted only when it's accessory to and operated in conjunction with a movie theater or an indoor children's play center. It would be limited to 10% of the gross floor area of that business. It would include amusement machines that are token operated only, so it would not be any money. And it would not have an independent access to the exterior of the building. So it wouldn't be, you know, have a separate kind of looking and entry and out. We want it to be integrated into this children's amusement center. It is specifically to deal with crash crawlies, but we feel that structure could support another children's play center. Probably unlikely to have too many of these around, but it would be very, very specific to that. This does not touch the current allowances for amusement arcades in shopping centers or in theaters. Those remain in place under the bylaw.
I tell you, I don't feel compelled to do this. I don't know that I feel comfortable with. If you ask me whether we're going to introduce these to our community, I'd say, "Oh, please don't. Let's not do that." And if you're asking me instead, let's regularize one that exists now, and I'm going to say the same thing. I actually get really a measure of discomfort walking through the arcade section of Playland, watching people who are really bad at math. Trying to figure out how to earn a $7 stuffy that is just a complete waste of space, and spending $40 to do it, and feeling the social pressure as well. And in many cases, these are teenagers that can't afford it. But when we start pushing this on 8-year-olds and 10-year-olds and 12-year-olds, whose parents feel the pressure, and at the birthday party or whatever, and it suddenly becomes a $100 birthday party instead of a $50 one, I'm really reluctant to do this. So, Councillor Nicholson, convince me.
Thank you, Your Worship. I appreciate Councillor Reamer's caution in speaking about what she knows and when she knew it and who she heard it from, particularly as I gather relates to hearing from Council. And on that basis, I would move that we defer this to a closed meeting where we can hear the full story and hear from Council as to what does this all really mean.
Does the clerk's office have any hesitation on that? The public hearing having ended.
And this issue clearly didn't come up during the public hearing, as no issue came up.
Was a good idea.
It has been the subject of a public hearing, and so no new information could be received by council. Clarifying information is, of course, okay.
Well, I don't have any information, so anything I get would be new.
No, it would be clarifying.
Go back to the public hearing.
Councillor Nicholson's motion is to refer it to an in-camera meeting, and we can determine at that point whether another.
What we hear in the in-camera meeting could be determined at that time.
The motion is to refer.
I'll second that.
No, May did.
Seconded by.
I was going to second almost anything.
Well, then I'm going to go with Councillor Hodge, who's seconding for the right reasons. Okay, the motion is to refer. Any discussion on referral? All in favor of referral? All opposed? Councillors Reamer and O'Neill are opposed. The motion carries.
Item 8 is an amendment to permit temporary sale centers on multifamily residential construction sites. The staff recommendation is that council give second, third, fourth, and final readings to zoning amendment bylaw number 4368-2012.
Second.
Moved by Councillor Rasmussen, seconded by Councillor Robinson. All in favor, opposed, carried.
Item 9, zoning amendment bylaw number 4362-2012 is a text amendment to subdivision regulations related to minimum lot size. Staff recommendations that council give second, third, fourth, and final readings to zoning amendment bylaw number 4362-2012.
Moved by Councillor O'Neill, seconded by Councillor Hodge. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously. We skipped over one item. We can consider it if you like. And that was on the minutes at 2, or the minutes at 3. No, the minutes at 2. 2.4, community and sports user group signage. Moved by Councillor Rasmussen, seconded by Councillor Reamer. My hesitation on this one is that I don't know that this solves anything other than. There was a discussion a while ago about the possibility of the city sponsoring in some way some kind of common signage framework that allows for the 1x4 slots for the various registrations, and we could have 4 or 5 slots available at each one of these sign locations, and it would be tidy and it would be bannered with a Coquitlam loves sports kind of a message or something like that. Instead, we're going to get a bunch of up to 4x8s tacked to a fence, various colors, and essentially what we have now only, what we have now at election season, only year-round. And I don't think that's the correct solution to the problem we have, which is a proliferation of signage at a number of locations. We'll just have a proliferation of signage at a number of locations that are all legal now, and I don't know that that's the solution. So that was my hesitation. Councillor Rasmussen.
Well, this has been something that has been before the Sports Council, Coquitlam Field Sports Association, for a number of years, realizing that they have to start to get a handle on the signage, sign location. I think within this is notating the signs in that area, but also regulating the time and stuff that signs can be up for the various sports and restricting it. And because right now we have signs throughout the community that are all over the place, creating some ugliness in signs. So I think this is a step in the direction to start to regulate this, and I think Councillor Hodge on the Sports Council can have some more detail, but this is something that's been raised by the sporting groups themselves about the need to take a step in this direction. I'm glad they raised it, and I think it's the direction we have to start to go. So those are my comments, and I'll
Councillor Hodge.
This is something that the Sports Council dealt with and worked with staff, particularly in bylaws. Members of the Sports Council who represent the various wide range of sports groups in the community recognize that there is a problem in the city, and they want to be part of the solution. And to them, their solution is to look at some regulations around the signs, make sure that there's dates on them, that they'd be only allowed to be up for a limited time, there'd be contact information on the back of the signs, and that they have chosen six locations here that represent different areas in the city so that they can reach out to the community. One of the challenges that we have is that these are groups that don't necessarily have other ways of getting the message out, and in the interest of increasing participation in our sports, we feel that it's important that they have a way of getting the message out. That having been said, a number of the groups are moving to electronic notices and building databases, and they are in themselves finding that there are better ways of getting the message out, but not for every group. So the hope is that by picking six locations and only allowing them in these locations, that it will make it easier to police other areas, because what happens is that the sports signs start going up in other places around the city. And then you get the fringe ones, sort of the music studios or the dance studio, the ones that really aren't sport. And then before you know it, you got the home renovations and everybody joins in. And I think the last roundup, we picked up over 500 signs. So the idea is, by limiting it to a small area, limiting the size, the length of time, that we at least put some parameters on it, and hopefully we can contain it. And if it doesn't work, then we'll have to go to another solution.
Thank you. Councillor O'Neill.
I'm reluctant to approve this. We have an advisory committee. I think advising us really that we should look at these permanent locations. But I'm loath to accept a definitive statement at this stage that these are these six things, and the motion is just for those six. It's not... In addition to do the other things that you talked about, that's not part of the motion. So if that were part of the motion, it'd be very much more specific, and then there'd be some more background. And we just heard verbally from you, and there was in the minutes there was something there. So I'm just uncomfortable with saying, oh yeah, let's do this. That's fine. Yeah. There's probably a bigger discussion, a study from various other groups about the implications for bylaw enforcement, the implications for who gets the prime spots on each fence, and I don't know. There's just, to go ahead right now, I think there's too many questions, so I'll oppose doing this. It's good initiative, and I think we do need a solution, but I'm not prepared to go ahead with it.
I'm going to ask for the microphone of the chair of that committee to be activated. Thank you. Councillor Hodge.
Just for further clarification, the committee worked with bylaws. Bylaws identified some locations that they felt were acceptable for sight lines and a number of criteria, including boulevard maintenance, safety concerns. Bylaws also ran it by a couple of other departments. They brought to the Sports Council about 10 different locations, and then Sports Council vetted it down, weeded it down to these six. So there was a lot of staff consultation along the way, and this was the final selection. So it was a collaborative discussion and between the number of departments.
Yeah. Well, then I don't know why we're not getting a report from the city solicitor or the bylaw department or something. I just feel more comfortable.
I believe there was an email that came out following that meeting that went out to all of council sort of as an update, but it was just an email.
Can I suggest either a motion to defer or a motion for requesting a staff report? Okay. Mr.
Through the chair, those are all good comments, and we can bring a report back for council if you like. We did send a memo to council in September and I believe another email update about the procedures around these signs, but we can bring a report forward to council just summarizing how this would work.
There's
and
no
allow council's feedback.
No rush. There's no immediate rush. No.
Excellent. Thank you. It satisfies my concern.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The motion's on the floor, though, so I'm going to need a motion to defer pending a staff report.
Motion to defer pending a staff report.
I'll second.
Moved by Councillor O'Neill, seconded by Councillor Nicholson, the Irish again. Any discussion on the motion to defer? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
I wish you'd quit referring.
Opposed.
Oh, I'm sorry. Councillor O'Neill, Councillor Reamer was opposed.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the motion carries. There is a notice of motion, apparently. We don't have to read it. We just have to say what the topic is.
The topic is single-family dwelling infill. It's a notice of motion presented by Councillor Sikora. Would you like me to read the motion? Notice of motion.
Okay.
That staff be directed to review the city zoning bylaw to identify options for council's consideration to either revise existing regulations or include additional provisions in the bylaw to mitigate the impact of large single-family dwelling new construction in established Coquitlam neighborhoods.
Something we've talked about several times. Okay, that motion will come before us before at the next council meeting. Any further announcements? I want to wish all of our home audience that's still up a Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, Yucca night, all of the other Kwanzaa. Thank you all for coming. Motion to adjourn. Moved by Councillor Robinson, seconded by Councillor Sikora. All in favor? Opposed? Carried. We now have an opportunity for a question period on tonight's agenda. Are there any questions? We ask people on tonight's agenda if they have any questions. Maximum 2 minutes. Please no preambles. Just go straight to the question. Any questions on tonight's agenda? Any questions on tonight's agenda? Third and final time. Mr. Dumont, any questions on tonight's agenda? Seeing none, thank you all for coming.